Hey guys, this is Nick from WSOU. I'm here with Stephen Keach, one of the vocalists from Haste the Day. How are you doing?
I'm doing well. How are you?
I'm doing pretty good. Since a lot has been going on the past almost a year now with you guys. A lot of different things, a lot of waiting has been happening, and things are finally starting to tie together. So, what exactly, where's your mind at with where everything is going so far?
Well, I am excited to play these shows. We've been trying to figure out a set list here. That's been our main focus right now because we have, six albums to play from now.
Right.
So it definitely makes it hard to choose. But yeah, I'm really I guess my mindset is just thankful that we were, able to finish up our record and now start focusing on these shows, and then once that's over, we can kind of go back to our normal lives.
Right. Now that was the interesting thing too I saw. So is this going to be the last record you guys put out?
I've learned not to say never.
Right.
And with that said, I have no idea. I mean, I was fully convinced that Attack of the Wolf King was going to be the last Haste Today record, and it turns out I was wrong, and I couldn't be more happy about it. So,
Right.
yeah, so I don't know what the future holds.
Okay. And that brings up the whole thing that the 10th anniversary of Burning Bridges, that show kind of brought everyone back together. What exactly started the, hey, let's try to, bring this back and do another album?
I don't know. I guess it was just a few conversations that we started having, especially after that show. Kind of got that show kind of got the ball rolling a little bit as far as just thinking about things. And for me, I don't know. It's easy to forget. I don't know. I kind of forgot about my passion for heavy music. So
Okay.
it kind of brought me back into that and got me excited about playing heavy music again. So
Okay. And the interesting thing is, usually when a band comes back, it's the original lineup or like a classic lineup. And it's really interesting that you guys are almost combining two lineups in a way with most of the original lineup and then also bringing in a few of the members from the Attack of the Wolf King lineup as well. Now, how do you think that affects kind of the sound of the band and the direction and the whole vibe, considering I'm assuming it's, there's a different kind of a outlook recording with, two different lineups of the band, sort of.
Well, I think we really wanted to capture not only a kind of a throwback sound, but just I don't know, just I mean, I guess the main idea behind putting everybody on this record was just to play with everybody and include everybody in the making of this record, because Haste Today has gone beyond just a five-member lineup, and it's always been kind of more. I feel like Haste Today has been more of an organization or an idea rather than just a five-member band,
Right.
And so we've as far as affecting the sound, I think it really gives it some of that throwback feel a little bit, but we're all so much older now and have changed, and our tastes are different, so there's a whole lot of new aspects to it as well.
Right. Now, how does it work with splitting vocals with Jimmy Ryan, especially when it came to the studio? What was the process of working on the different songs and who was going to do what and such like that?
Yeah, it was really fun and cool to work with Jimmy. They kind of left up deciding who would do what. They kind of left that up to me to decide. And with that said, I kind of let Jimmy pick his favorite songs, and we kind of went with that, you know. And I think it was awesome as far as like the overall vibe of the record and the overall theme of the lyrics and all that stuff. I think Jimmy has a lot of really great things to say and contribute, and his vocal style is really cool on this record. We tried some new things, and yeah, overall, I think it turned out pretty awesome.
Yeah, and now, since you guys had a lot of time off before you guys worked on this album, was there anything, was this all done, you know, after the, hey, let's make a new album, or was there songs, you know, that maybe you or Jimmy were working on prior to the band getting back together that you brought forward, like, hey, I have some new material, or did you guys work on this just as soon as it was, the idea came up, like, let's write a new record together?
I think everything was written after we decided to make a new record.
Okay.
I don't know if any of us were writing heavy stuff on our own.
Mm-hmm.
So,
okay. Now, what exactly, you know, the album is entitled Coward, and what exactly, because it's kind of like a little different than, you know, the normal stuff that you guys were really doing. What exactly inspired Coward and the songs and stuff like that?
You know, over the last couple of years, I've seen a lot of relationships and a lot of marriages fall apart, and it's all kind of stemming from the idea that people just don't really know how to communicate.
Mm-hmm.
And people are too scared to communicate what they actually feel. And I think that just goes to show that every one of us has the potential to be a coward, and every one of us has the potential to choose to rise above that and actually communicate what we are feeling. I'm sure everybody can relate to a spouse or somebody you're in a relationship with being, you know, too scared to actually tell you the truth about how they feel about you and what that leads to and the destruction that leads there.
Okay.
And also, I mean, I see myself acting as a coward a lot in my relationship with God, as far as like acting on what I feel like He's called me to be, and how a lot of times I take the easy road and am too afraid to actually walk in what He has for me. And then, I have to make the choice to overcome that cowardice, you know?
Mm-hmm. And that you guys are definitely carrying that message still.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Now, I know you produced this record, correct?
Yeah.
Now, how was that working? Did you produce the ones that you were on previously?
No, I did not. We had some other great producers on those records.
Okay.
But yeah, this was, I've been, after the band, after the band ended in 2011, I started, working more, as a producer engineer.
Okay.
And doing things in Nashville, recording a lot of indie bands and, not too many heavy bands, but this was a really fun project for sure.
Mm-hmm, definitely. How was that producing a heavy band, especially your own band?
I've been around so much heavy music that it wasn't too much of a stretch or anything. It was
right.
I kind of already knew what I wanted to hear from the guitar tones and the drums and all that stuff.
Right.
As far as producing my own band, that definitely has its challenges, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Not only was I producing, I was writing and singing and I was talking to one of the other guys in the band the other day, and I was like, man, I think I've listened to these songs more than anyone should ever listen to any song ever. And it's just so funny because it's like, I'm listening to them when I'm, you know, writing the music. I'm listening to them when I'm writing the lyrics. I'm listening to them when we're tracking drums, when we're tracking guitars, when we're tracking bass, you know, and so on and so forth. But it was really, really awesome to be so close to the project. You know, I just love creating music. And I was really excited about the way this record turned out to be. Heavy but still really raw and kind of dirty and more true to how we actually play our instruments, you know, and I was pretty excited about that.
Now, I thought an interesting thing was you did the gang vocals at your church.
Yeah, I did.
Talk to me about that a little bit, because I thought that was really interesting when I read that.
Well, we did a like an Indiegogo perk, to have, you know, you can, you know, buy that tier or whatever on the Indiegogo and you get to do gang vocals on the record. And, the studio is just not really conducive for, I'm really close with, my pastor and, I lead worship at my church, a couple times a month. And, I was able to, snag our awesome building for some gang vocals and definitely took advantage of that. It's really old. It's like a Civil War era building, so the acoustics in it are really cool.
Right. Now, I thought that was interesting too, because I know a lot of bands have been doing like fans on their gang vocals, which I think is a really cool way to kind of get fans involved in the actual music making process.
Oh yeah.
Now, speaking of Indiegogo, the whole album was made off of the Indiegogo campaign you guys started, and you only were asking for $65,000, and I checked it, and you guys had $139,276, which it said was 214% of what you guys were looking for. Did you guys even expect to even reach your goal originally? Like, what was your expectations and how did you feel about that, knowing you made more than double what you were asking?
Well, we did what we or what they call a flex goal in the beginning, which means if you don't make your goal, you can still, you know, you can still go forth with your project,
right?
And keep whatever you do make. You know, we definitely did not expect to go over our goal, and we were nervous that we weren't even going to hit our goal. I mean, we were hoping,
right?
You know, but it always is, you know, a little nerve wracking. And I remember when we hit our goal early, and we were all like texting each other, like, "Oh my gosh! Like, how on earth these people, like, you know, that's I don't know, it's just mind blowing that our fans still cared and you know, cared that much and that deeply, and especially, like, you know, to oversell our pass our goal,
right,
was unbelievable as well, especially by as much as we did.
Right. Now, since you guys were only asking for $65,000 for the album, what did the other money go towards, or did you guys just dump all that into the recording?
Well, I think a lot of people, as far as what I've been reading online, I think a lot of people are confused about how, like, a crowdfunding campaign works.
Mm-hmm.
Now, when you each incentive costs so much money for us to make, you know,
right?
And so, so when you, like, with, like, all of the money that we got, like, it's still, you know, it's a ton of money, but that made all of our incentives so much more for us to make.
Okay.
So it mostly just means, you know, our, like, we were able to put a little bit more into recording. We were able to, you know, live a, like, basically pay for the time that we had to take off to make this album.
Right.
And then we were able to afford all the incentives. I think a lot of young bands, especially, they always forget to include how much it's going to cost to print all the CDs and create all the hoodies and
right.
And all the vinyl is pretty expensive. And oh my gosh! And we just did our handwritten lyric books. None of us expected. I guess we just didn't really think that incentive through very well, and we ended up with 91 handwritten lyric books sold. And between, you know, I think four of us were working on them, and I have 24 myself, and it took about an hour and a half to 2 hours to do one.
Wow.
And it was like some hours logged in just those, but definitely were amazed by how much we made. But, you know, I think a lot of people think that, you know, we get to live the life of luxury and all this stuff, but, you know, it takes a long time, takes a lot of work.
Right.
And in the end you realize that, most of that money is just kind of going to take care of business. So,
right. Now, how do you feel, especially since now you guys were a part of it, do you think crowdfunding is the way to go?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
I mean, it kind of depends on the band, on the I think that it takes a dedicated group of people to successfully run a crowdfunding campaign.
Mm-hmm.
We had a really great manager. Who had a lot of really amazing ideas and was able to kind of be the point man for all of the building of the campaign and all that stuff. And he's really good at budgeting and, you know, keeping things right. But I do know a lot of young artists who get themselves in trouble sometimes because they don't budget right or,
right.
You know, it's just, and crowdfunding, I think it's really cool because, a lot of people, you know, even I thought when I first, I kind of hated it when it first came out, I was like, oh my gosh, these people are begging for money. Right. And the thing is that it's really not like that at all. It's a giant pre-order basically.
Yeah.
So you're creating the demand for it and getting your capital up front. And there's absolutely nothing wrong with that. It's actually like much better than, you know, pouring too much money and wasting all this money and going into debt with a label or something.
Right.
Where you don't know if you'll ever actually be able to pay it off.
Mm-hmm.
But now if you, I think some bands definitely need, probably most bands need labels because they've been doing what they do for a long time and are really good at it.
Yeah.
So I don't think that a label is the wrong route to go either. So.
Mm-hmm. Now, jumping to the show aspect, you guys played the reunion show, the 10th anniversary show for Burning Bridges last year, and you have, at the moment, four shows booked for the album release at the end of this month. Are those going to be the only four shows that you guys are going to play, or are there more in the works at the current time?
Well, again, I can't really ever say never.
Right.
So, but as far as we know, those are our last four shows in the foreseeable future.
Okay.
So that's all we're planning for. That's all we really have time for is, you know, the guys only have so much time off work and,
mm-hmm.
You know, families at home and all that stuff. So we're trying to have as much fun as we can in these four shows and then call it for at least a little while.
Okay. So what should fans expect at these shows? What do you guys, I know obviously you're going to be combining both new material and your older stuff. What should fans expect from you guys at these four shows?
Yeah, definitely a good, well-rounded set of as many songs as we can play from each record. You know, we we have six records to choose from, so we're trying to create an even balance and at the same time showcase our newer songs.
Right.
And, you know, we'll have some, a few kind of member changes and throughout the set sometimes. And yeah, it'll be a fun time.
Awesome.
Expect us to be old and out of breath. I started running this morning, so I was like, well, you know, I should run all the time, but
gotta get ready for this.
I was thinking about that reunion show, and yeah. I just played one song with the guys. Definitely feel the need to get back in shape before these shows.
Right.
Especially the Colorado show, because that high altitude always kills me.
That's very, very true. Is that actually, I never even thought about that. I guess where you play does have an effect. I never really thought of that. That's
very... I mean, I think Colorado is the most, it's the most different place that we can play. It's funny because I grew up in Colorado. I grew up in Denver playing at the venue that we're going to be playing. And now that I'm so not accustomed to the altitude, it always kills me.
So how did you guys pick the four locations?
I think they were all cities that we remember doing pretty well in, and they're all spread out across the country, at least. So they might not be the closest city to you, but might be easier than maybe just doing a West Coast run or an East Coast run.
Right.
Easier for more people to get out to each one.
Mm-hmm. All right. Well, that wraps about everything up. So thank you so much for your time, Steve.
Yeah, no problem.